Right, just readjusting the webcam and then we can start looking at factorising completely. So you might like to start looking at this one. So whenever it says factorise completely, it generally means that there's more than one factor that you've got to take outside a bracket. So it's possible to factorise but not factorise completely. So we're thinking here, what do the numbers have in common and what do the letters have in common? Well, if we look at the numbers, first of all, 6 and 10, both even numbers, aren't they? So they have 2 in common. That's the highest common factor of 6 and 10. And then if we look at the letters, they have an N in common. So we can take 2N outside a bracket. And then we're looking at the 6N squared. I'm thinking about how are we going to get 6n squared by multiplying 2n by something. So we're going to multiply 2 by 3, and then we're going to be multiplying n by n to get n squared. So that will be 3n. And then to get minus 10n, it's going to be minus, and then all we need to do is multiply 2 by 5. And the n is what we want anyway. So 2n times 5 is minus 10n. Okay, so next one. So the next one, we're going to just have letters this time. So we'll have some p's and q's. So p cubed multiplied by q plus p squared q cubed. So we're looking here at what we've got in common. So no numbers this time, apart from the powers. So we're looking at the p first of all. And we're not just looking to factorise, but factorise completely. So we want to think about the highest power of p. So we've got p cubed in the first term and p squared in the second one. So we're going to write down p squared, because p squared divides into both p squared and p cubed. That's the highest common factor of p squared and p cubed. And then we're going to look at q and q cubed. And the highest common factor of those is simply q. So often the hardest bit is working that bit out. Once you've got the bit outside the bracket, the rest of it just follows on. So now we open a bracket and we're looking at the p cubed q and thinking about what do we need to multiply p squared q by to get that. Well, the q is fine because we've already got a q there, but we haven't got p cubed, we've got p squared. So we need to multiply p squared by p, and then we will get p cubed. Q's looked after. So then we're going to put in the plus, and now we want to get p squared q cubed. Well, we've already got p squared, so that's fine, but we haven't got q cubed. So now we're thinking about what do we need to multiply q by to get the q cubed? And we want to get q squared. So there, we would always check when we're asked to factorise completely that when we've got a bracket, there are no common factors left in the bracket, because if there were, it would mean we haven't completely factorised. We can see there's nothing in common between the p and q squared there. And in the earlier question, we can see nothing in common when we look at the 3n and the 5. Right, so next one. So this time we'll have numbers and two different letters. So let's have 25 multiplied by d squared h. And then the other term, so we've got plus 15 dh squared. Right, so looking at the numbers first, whenever you're doing this, if there are any numbers there, deal with the numbers first. So we're looking at 25 and 15 and thinking, what's the highest common factor? So 5 is the highest common factor there, isn't it? So we've got 5. Then we're going to look at the letters in alphabetical order. So this time we've got a number and two different letters to look at. So we've dealt with the number. Now we're looking at the D squared and the D and thinking about what do they have in common. Well, it's D, isn't it? That's the highest common factor. So we've got 5D. And then we're looking at the H and the H squared. So that's similar, isn't it? We've got an H in common there. So the highest common factor is 5DH. So now we're ready to open a bracket. We're going to have to move this up a bit. I know what. I'm just going to fold this over so that we don't lose the hand side of the page. I should have started further over, shouldn't I? Right. We've got space now to finish. Right, so we've got 5DH. And we want to multiply term by term. So we've got to multiply 5 by 5 to get 25. We want to get D squared, so we need to multiply D by D. So D times D will give us D squared. We already have the H, so that bit's sorted. So now we want the plus. So we've got 5D plus, and we're trying to get 15 times DH squared. So we're looking at 15 and 5. 5 goes into 15 three times. We've already got the D, that's sorted. We want H squared, so we need to multiply H by H. And then we check that 5D and 3H don't have any common factor, and they don't, so that's done. Right, next one. So we'll do another one that's got numbers and letters in. So let's have, that would have been, I was trying to write 24. I was trying to write 2 and 4 at the same time. Right, so 24, x squared y minus 60 xy cubed. So we're looking at what 24 and 60 have in common. So we're looking for the highest common factor. So what's the highest common factor of 24 and 60? So you could look at those two numbers and think they're both even numbers. So 2 could be the common factor. It is a common factor, but not the highest common factor. What's the highest common factor of 24 and 60? It doesn't matter if you choose the a number that's not the highest one, because you will be able to rectify it later on. It's a bit like cancelling fractions, where you don't have to use the highest one to start with, but you need to get there in the end before you give your final answer. Anyway, if we look at these two numbers, you should have worked out by now that the highest common factor of 24 and 60 is 12. So there's our number. And x squared and x have a highest common factor of x, and y cubed have a highest common factor of y. And now it's just a matter of working out what goes inside the brackets. So 12 into 24 goes twice. So we want a 2 there. We just need to multiply the x by x. Y doesn't need to appear here, does it? And then we want a minus 60 divided by 12 is 5. And we then don't need an x, but we do want a y. And we're going to get y squared in there, I think. Now let's have a look. Yejwin has given an answer that, well, look at what he's done there. He's different colors. So I think my answer is the factorized completely answer, if I haven't gone right. I'll just quickly check it. 12 twos are 24. X times x is x squared. Then we've got a y. And that's 24x squared y. And then the other bit, minus 5y squared times 12xy is going to be minus 60xy cubed. And the other check is that these two terms don't have anything in common. Now, we have got an alternative answer that somebody's given us there. 6xy, 4x plus, you mean minus? I think you mean minus. Yeah, minus, otherwise it's going to be the wrong sign, 10y, and that looks like a cubed, but I think you mean squared. So if we had written that down as our answer and tried multiplying it out, 6 4s are 24, x to x is x squared, and y does give us the right thing for 24x squared y, and the 6xy times minus 10y squared does give us minus 60xy cubed, but can you see that the 4 and the 10 have a factor of 2. So that tells us we have factorised, but not factorised completely if we've given that as our answer. So that's why it's so important to read the question. If it says factorised completely, this would not be an answer. Yeah, it would be a way of factorising the given expression, but it wouldn't be completely factorised. It's a bit like if you're cancelling down a fraction. Like if I gave you the fraction... In fact, we could do 24 over 60. I gave you that fraction and you thought, oh yeah, I can cancel that down. That's going to be 12 over 30. But then that's not in its lowest terms. To give that in its lowest terms, we would have to keep going, wouldn't we? And think, that can be cancelled down again. Maybe we could halve both numbers again and get 15 and 6. But that's still not there. We'd have to keep on going, wouldn't we? And we would actually have to keep on going until we got to 2/5. So it's the same kind of thing. When we're doing factorise completely, it's like giving a fraction in its lowest terms. This would be the only way of giving the fraction in its simplest terms, by giving it as 2/5, not as 12/30 or 6/15 or 4/10. Right, so I think we need another piece of paper now for the next one. Okay, so what should we have next? Let's have a nice big number. Let's start with 84. Let's see if you can actually see it. Right, 84. A squared D. Plus 14. A to the fourth D squared. So what are we going to start with there? What's the highest common factor of 84 and 14? So this time, we actually could say it's 14. So 14 itself goes into both 14 and 84. And then looking at the a squared and the a to the fourth, highest common factor will be a squared. And then looking at the d and the d squared, highest common factor is d. And then 14's into 84 goes 6 times. And then we've got the a squared d, haven't we? So that's all we've got there. And then we're going to have plus, and we've already got the 14, but we then need to multiply a squared by a squared to get a to the fourth, and d by d to get d squared. So that's that one done. And what we haven't done yet is one with three different letters, so let's do that next. So we'll have 16x, y, z. And next term, minus 9 x squared y times z cubed. So when you've got factorised completely, you don't always necessarily have a number in common. So 16 and 9 don't have the highest common factor, or rather their highest common factor will be 1. So that's not going to give us any number that comes outside the bracket. So we're just going to have letters outside. So what's that going to be? What is our highest common factor in terms of these letters X, Y, and Z? Well, both of them have got an X, both of them have got a Y, and both of them have got a Z. So X, Y, Z is our highest common factor. So that when we open the bracket, all we need is 16 to get the 16X, Y, Z, and then to get the minus 9X squared, Y, Z cubed, you're going to have X squared multiplying. No, we're not, just an X, aren't we? We've got the X outside, so that's just an X. And then we don't need a Y, but we do need a Z squared. And that's it. So any other questions that you have? I think we've more or less covered the sort of thing that's likely to appear in GCSE maths anyway. And now you should be able to do the question I put in the community post recently. Hopefully. Okay, so we'll leave it there then. Thank you for coming.